A very warm welcome to the Lung Cancer Connect Lung Foundation Australia webinar. The Lung Cancer Connect project is a Cancer Australia supporting patients with cancer grant initiative funded by the Australian Government. The Lung Foundation acknowledges the traditional custodians, past and present, of the land which we live and work. My name is Claire Mulverhill and I'm the Lung Cancer Support Nurse working at Lung Foundation Australia. And today we have many people joining us across Australia, so a very warm welcome to all of you. Before we open up with our discussion today, I would like to take the opportunity just to go through some of the normal housekeeping rules. If you experience a technical problem, please let us know via the chat box or follow the prompts on your screen. I understand that headphones will improve your audio. I encourage you to also use the chat box to ask the presenter any questions you have during the presentation, as this webinar is directly for you and for your benefit too. If your question is not answered, we will endeavour to get back to you early next week and address any of your queries. For those registered for today's webinar, you'll be able to access the webinar via a link that will be emailed to you after today's session. Otherwise, the recorded webinar will be uploaded onto the website in coming weeks. Please know, at any stage, if you feel an urgent need to connect and reach out to speak to somebody, please call Lifeline 13 11 14 and they're available 24 hours, 7 days a week. So, an introduction to today's session. Today's webinar topic is we're going to discuss the psychosocial needs of patients living with lung cancer. And it is with great pleasure that we are joined by Suzanne Chambers, who's the director of the Menzies Health Institute in Queensland. So, thank you so much for joining us today, Suzanne. And the importance of discussing the psychosocial needs of these lung cancer patients, which is so important. But to set the scene for today, I thought it'd be good to start off with just giving an overall recap of where we've come in really the last decade in our cancer treatments for lung cancer. We've seen the mainstays of treatments being surgery and chemotherapy and radiotherapy. We've seen refinements in them in the last 10 years. For example, surgery, we've gone from thoracotomies, open thoracotomies, to looking at doing keyhole surgery procedures. We're seeing CT screening to help detect lung cancers a lot earlier to improve outcomes. We're seeing refinement in radiotherapy, stereotactic therapy. But with all these treatments, we're seeing really a change in lung cancer treatment, but we're also now seeing the ability to not just look at the disease as itself as one with just set treatments, but with the molecular drivers that are starting to be noted through pathology, we're now seeing an introduction of targeted therapies and immunotherapies, which is certainly changing the landscape of treating patients. And so now with the targeted therapies and with these immunotherapies that are improving outcomes for patients, we are also seeing the need to utilise the multidisciplinary team a lot more in accessing our allied health professionals, psychologists, counsellors, social workers, etc. And we're seeing patients living longer, improvement quality of life, but with that comes psychological supports and emotional supports for these patients. So I suppose the question is, what are these types of needs for these lung cancer patients, and what are some of the strategies that you could impart with the patients living with lung cancer in this new changing landscape of what we're seeing now.
Okay, well, thank you, Claire, for that kind invitation, and thanks everybody who's called in on their, if you, that's the right word to use, on their computers today. I feel very honoured that you would be joining us to talk about these things. And it is great to see all these improvements that are occurring in the treatment landscape for lung cancer. And it is interesting to note that it really is only over the last, you know, decade or two, the psychological needs and the emotional experience of having cancer and having lung cancer has started to become recognised, with health professionals paying attention to the idea that we're not just here to treat a disease, we're here to look after a whole person. You know, if we think about the diagnosis of cancer, that's always been a major difficult life experience for anybody at any time. And I suppose when you're thinking about different treatments coming along, what that means is there's a layer of complexity of needing to understand sometimes quite complex terms and sometimes make difficult decisions that have different costs and benefits about how you proceed. I've got some slides I thought that I would run through, Claire, to mostly as a prompt for my memory to make sure I don't forget to tell you all things that I think are important. I guess a bit of background about me. I'm a nurse and I'm a psychologist. I've been working with people with cancer for a few decades now, and like most people, have personal cancer experiences with my close family. So we all know that you know, that moment when you find out about a cancer diagnosis, either for yourself or someone close to you, is a moment that you really always remember, and it can be a quite shocking experience. And so when people find out they've got cancer, it's common to feel a sense of disconnection with the world, feeling very stressed, anxious and tearful, and wondering about what does this mean now for me, and what is it going to mean for me tomorrow, and what is it going to mean for me and for my family in the future. Those things run through most people's minds. And at the same time, wondering about how did this happen, you know, and often people search for something to blame, whether they're going to blame themselves or blame someone around them. Not such a helpful thing to do, searching for blame, but it's something that we often do. And at some point, searching for trying to find what's the meaning of this going to be for my life. So all of these types of emotions can go through the minds of a person who's having a cancer diagnosis, as well as their family. When I first started working in the area of cancer many years ago, patients would often say to me they felt like they were stuck in a maze. They didn't know what was around the corner. They weren't sure how long it was going to take to the end, and sometimes they wondered if they were ever going to get to the end. And I remember at the time that struck me as being a useful way to think about it, because if you think about it in that way, you can say, well, what can I find out about? What can I learn to help me get through that maze a little more easily? And so when we talk about using psychological techniques or psychological approaches in cancer, we can't change the fact of the situation in which you find yourself, but you can search around and go, is there some meaning in this, and some tools that I could use or people close to me could use that could make it a little easier to get to where I'm going. Does that make sense?
Absolutely, and it's that identity within all of that, and finding that connection. I think what you said there, the meaning is so important, and to make sense of what they're facing.
And that takes time. Yeah. All of these things take time, you know, sort of talking about it as if it's a process of just moving through, but it's not a straight line. It's an up and down when different things happen in the cancer experience. It's an up and down of experiences, and days when the sun is up and the sky looks blue, and days when it doesn't feel that way at all. And that can be one of the most challenging things, is to be accepting that as what it is.
It's interesting you say that, because this morning we had a face-to-face support group, and what some of the patients raised was the unpredictability of what they're going to be feeling from one day to the next, and not realising that that vulnerability is just under the surface, and how they navigate their way through that with the unpredictability of what disease is.
Accepting that, I guess, and getting tools to help. I've just put up on the slide there, this is a slide I've been using for about 20 years.
So if I ever,
but you know, when I first started working with people with cancer, I would search my books and search, talk to others and say, does this seem to make sense to you? Does this help you? And this is the model that, in the end I had a lot of people coping with cancer tell me made sense to them. So what we're saying there is, the diagnosis of lung cancer is a major life stress. Like in some ways, like other things that happen, the longer you live, the more likely you are to have something negative happen to you, whether it's an accident or a divorce or losing someone close to you or losing a job. And it's through these experiences, of course, that we develop, you know, resilience and tools to help us cope with the difficulties life throws at us. But this analytic way of looking at it is to say that when something happens to us that's a major life stressor, like cancer, for example, without even realizing it, we have thoughts that come into our mind, and we might not even be aware of them, that are telling us what this means. We're trying to work it out. And so the thoughts might be fears of, is this going to kill me? Is this what's going to end my life? Or are people going to love me tomorrow? Or am I going to be able to do my job? All sorts of thoughts will pop into our heads in an automatic way. And those thoughts will lead to different feelings. So, for example, this is a sort of a banal example, but, you know, if you, walk out the door and your car's not in the driveway and you immediately think someone stole my car, the emotional response to that is quite different to walking out and going, oh, that's right, I left the car down the road. The actual facts of the matter are the same, but the thoughts in your head about what you're seeing drive your emotions. And that's really important to get that thought and feeling connection, because as you're going through these experiences, if you find there are times when you're just feeling more distressed than normal, it can, there might be a pervasive thought that is popping up. And we can do something about that, because the one thing we can change is the way we think about something. I'm not talking about positive thinking. That's very annoying when people tell you to think positive, and I would never do that. Never do that. But, you know, sometimes I talk to people who are constantly thinking it's all my fault, or blaming themselves a lot, or thinking it's all going to be terrible, and nothing's ever, those absolute statements are never the truth, ever, you know. So changing those thoughts can help with feelings. In that model, you'll also see it's got physical reactions, and that's acknowledging that when we have certain types of thoughts and feelings, our body reacts as if there's a threat. It's the fight or flight response, which is very helpful if you're faced by a lion or a tiger and you're out in the desert and you need to either run or you need to fight. But when you're stuck in a chair in front of a doctor who's telling you stuff you don't want to hear, and your adrenaline and noradrenaline starts churning around in your body and your blood pressure goes up and your mouth goes dry, not so helpful. Why am I telling you this? Well, because there are techniques, stress management techniques that we can use to manage those physical reactions a little. And some of them are very easy. I'll be talking about them as we go along, and you can get skilled at those. And when you're in a situation where you notice that this is happening, you can go, okay, what can I do right now? This is what I can do. So we'll talk about those. And actions, which is the piece down the bottom, is really acknowledging that there's also behaviours we do that can be helpful for us. And sometimes they're helpful and sometimes they're not. So an example I often give people there is to say that, you know, if you're stuck on a bed in the doctor's room and they're trying to take blood out of your arm, closing your eyes and pretending that you're in the bus on a beach might be a very useful avoidance strategy. But if you're sitting in the kitchen and someone close says, I need to understand about your cancer, and you close your eyes and go, I'm in the Bahamas, I'm in the Bahamas, that's probably not going to be so helpful. So it's, you know, again, it's not about valuing any of these as right or wrong. It's just about saying there are different ways you can act and different ways you can think, and they have implications for the, for you in a reaction to stress. And this is what we talk about when we talk about coping skills training. I'm going, that's just a slide to acknowledge, which I've mentioned earlier, really, the very difficult feelings that are very common after a diagnosis of lung cancer. And, you know, we all have our own different patterns of how we tend to feel under pressure. Some of us get cranky, some of us withdraw and act like it's all okay, some of us cry a lot. All of these things are all right. It's just, I'm just trying to acknowledge, I guess, that this happens. I'm sure you must see this, Claire.
A lot. And I used to, as in the coal face, we, you know, working as a lung cancer nurse coordinator, you saw a lot of, the shock was visible upon diagnosis, and trying to take in that information to help that patient consolidate what they've just heard. And the guilt is a huge issue for some patients with their own histories that they come with. And the angst of what to expect because it's the unknown.
Yeah.
They're about to embark on a path that they just don't understand or know what to expect.
And even if you know, the experience of it is different to the personal experience. The experience of going through it is different to...
Absolutely.
You can think, you know, as a health professional, I thought I knew. No, not
no,
really.
No. Because your emotion comes in
yeah.
as well. You know, that when you're a health professional and then you have that personal experience, it's very, very different to what you think it might be.
So I'm just going to briefly comment on stigma in lung cancer. It's something that we know exists, that people who have a diagnosis of lung cancer, and like everybody looks for, any cancer people look for something to blame, but it's very easy in lung cancer to feel like people are blaming you and to blame yourself. And, you know, that's, I guess, what a nice statement. I know Quan Phong often says, you know, no one deserves lung cancer and everyone mm-hmm. deserves treatment. So I just want to acknowledge that and say that I think it's really important for people with lung cancer and those around them to be kind to themselves and be compassionate to themselves and, you know, try and work to a state of acceptance and not blame yourself.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Because that's just not on,
no.
really.
And I
using
think
the technical term.
Not on. And I think the lovely word that you used there, which we were talking about before to today's webinar, is the compassion.
Okay, that's just, I put this up just because I know I've had people with lung cancer say to me, where's my book on the sisterhood of lung cancer and hearing the stream? And that's a book actually on breast cancer, but that sometimes people feel like they don't, there's a difference in mm-hmm. how things are perceived, and I'm just acknowledging that and saying we need to work against that. That was a quote, I've just put up there a quote from a health professional who certainly told me in relation to this idea of stigma that there was a sense that wasn't as important as other cancers and, mm-hmm. and that not enough help was around. Mm-hmm. So I'm acknowledging mm-hmm. that and saying that what we're all working very hard on with the Lung Foundation is to try and change those.
Absolutely.
And you've got to focus on that coming up.
We do, we do. So in regards to Parliamentary Friends in October, focusing on bringing lung cancer to the fore and the importance of the supportive care and also looking at next year embarking in some research to defining the role of the lung cancer nurse coordinator and the framework around that and the difference that that role can make in a patient's outcomes.
So I'm going to start talking about strategies that might be helpful to you, but I really want to emphasise that this is not about giving you a lecture and saying you have to do things this way or that way. There are no right or wrong ways to react. And in these situations, we all do the best we can. And we all have our own preferences for how we cope. And I think it's really important to emphasise that. What we do know, though, is that being flexible does help.
Mm-hmm.
And all that's saying really is that if you know, we've all got our ways we like to deal with things, but if you're finding you're getting stuck and you're not able to get the outcome that you wanted, might be an idea to think about trying some different strategies.
Mm-hmm.
And so I often think about it as just learning and getting some extra tools. What we do know from the research is that it is harder if you don't have enough good information, and so an action that you can take is getting the information you need. It's harder if you don't have sensible or experienced support, and I'm qualifying that because there's some support's not so helpful. You know,
mm-hmm.
sometimes people
mm-hmm.
try to be helpful and it can be a bit, you know, to the contrary.
Yeah.
Important to be clear about what support looks like for you to others, being clear to your health professionals, family, what it is that you would like them to do,
mm-hmm.
Because they're not going to be able to read your mind.
Mm-hmm.
So being clear about those things, trying not to let yourself get too isolated, so keeping connected into your social networks, you need to know where to get help, and there is help around. And even though sometimes we don't want to talk to those close to us because we're trying to protect them, we actually know that talking at least some of the time about what you're going through does seem to measurably make a difference in how you're managing. So it's just worth thinking about those things, because sometimes I see people who will say, I'm not telling anyone because they'll just worry. But in actual fact, they're worrying anyway, and worrying more because they're fantasizing about what's going on. So some a level of honesty and openness. What we're not going to do is just, this is a little cartoon I love saying, just pull yourself together, because that's not really helpful advice. I'm suggesting it's a toolbox approach. There are lots of different ways to fix things or to change things, and sometimes if you're fixing a car engine, you're not going to do it all with a wrench. You'll need multiple tools. So if you think about coping as having a toolbox, try one tool, doesn't work so well, maybe think about trying another, and that's that sort of flexibility idea that I'm talking about. There are lots of pieces of information around to give you tips for decision making, tried and true mechanisms to manage stress, making sure that there is time every now and again at least to talk about cancer, but that doesn't mean talking about it all the time, negotiating that with people around you, working on how you think about the cancer into be a way that's more helpful for you, approaches to problem solving, and then setting goals and get the most out of life, because when you're going through treatment, life seems to get out of control and it all revolves around treatment. So trying to find some time to say, well, what are the things I'm going to do for me that aren't about cancer? Mm-hmm. And
is it so easy to be fixated, isn't it?
Very hard not to think about it all the time.
Absolutely. So it is that internal struggle of getting that balance right, and having some of those personal goals as well. They just in the support group, we had it was lovely to hear a patient going off to Tasmania for a month, you know, because that was important for her, person weight. So which is really important.
Yeah.
But personal goals is something that I really resonate to for the patients.
Yeah.
It's important.
Okay, so I'm going to talk very briefly about decision making, and you know, it can be very hard to make decisions about cancer. You don't necessarily understand what they're talking about. Sometimes either option doesn't sound great. Trying to choose between tough options, no one can ever really tell you what will happen. They can give you statistics about what happens with groups of people, but what will actually happen to you is really unknown, which is hard to accept. Trying to understand what the doctors are telling you when they use percentages of risk of this and that, it's hard to imagine what does that really mean for you, and you're already stressed. Our minds are in a way like our cognitive workspace. So when we're relaxed, it's very, you know where everything is on your workspace. But when you're stressed, everything feels cluttered and it's hard to find things and move it around.
Yeah.
So trying to make a decision when you're feeling really stressed is hard. Sometimes it's better to go to yourself, I'm going to wait till tomorrow and wake up in the morning fresh, and then I'm going to think this through, or I'm going to set this up where I've got people who can help me with this decision making to talk this through. So this is some tips here to take your time, be informed, trying to understand the pros and cons from your point of view, and sometimes writing them down. I know when one of my sisters was diagnosed with breast cancer and she was trying to decide about chemotherapy, and I very bossily told her she needed to sit down with her partner, get a piece of paper out and write down the pros and cons, and she looked like she thought I should stop acting like a psychologist, but the next day she said, you know, it was really boring, but I did it and it helped. So it's something to consider anyway.
Yeah.
And if you have your pros and cons list written down too, you can talk. It gives you a structure to talk it over with people, so you can take it to the doctor and go, have I got this right? Talk it over with them. You can talk it over with your family so they understand the decisions that you're making. Other quick tips, it's really good to take a support person to your doctor's visit if you can. Can be really helpful to talk to someone who's had a previous experience similar to yours, because you do get a different perspective from someone who's been there, done that. And if a second opinion would help, ask for someone.
And that's, you know, I think it's important that patients are not frightened to seek that second opinion. There are many patients who will ring the support line here at Lung Foundation to say, is it okay? Am I going to offend my clinician. And absolutely not. I think it's really important that there's that open communication and that you are equipping yourself with the best amount of knowledge to help you move forward on your treatment journey, because it's actually impacting you as an individual. So I think that second opinion can be warranted.
I think so. I mean, sometimes you don't, you know, can make a decision that you don't want one, and that's okay. If you're trying to make a tough decision and you think it would help, then absolutely ask for that decision. So I've talked about the stress cycle before, and that's just really a better picture of it that I got someone to draw for me. But it's really what we're trying to get to is the idea that this stress can be managed. You can't take the stressful situation away for you, but it can be managed. Because if you don't, it's like keeping your foot on the throttle on a car and never taking it off, that constant push. What will happen if you ignore the stress? You keep your foot on the throttle the whole time, you'll get more tired, irritable, reduced energy, loss of stamina, and relationships can get strained. You're constantly revving that engine, there's consequence for that. And so for short periods of time, that's okay, but cancer experiences are rarely short term. It could go on for some time. Managing stress is a really important part of getting through that experience. So there are lots of tools for de-stressing, and they really do work. So relaxation exercises like deep breathing and meditation are simple. You can do simple controlled breathing exercises where, there'll be materials that you can access easily for this online. Just things as simple as counting slowly for four when you breathe in, holding for two, and counting slowly for four out. Understanding, of course, that if you're having difficulty breathing, you may have some other advice that's been given to you. But just controlling your breathing slows your body down. You can drop your blood pressure, and it really can be quite calming. And if you can get good at that technique, it's something that you can do while you're waiting to see the doctor. If you're in the doctor and you start to feel that you're getting a bit revved up, you can do that. Meditation is very good for quietening the mind. Strategies that you can be taught, it comes from the Buddhist tradition, and that often people will do mindfulness approaches as well, but meditative techniques can be really good just for giving your mind a break. Very good for helping you get to sleep as well. Exercise is really good and really important to do. We know that exercise will help keep your muscles working. It helps with fatigue. It might seem funny to say that if you exercise more, you'll get less tired, but it does work. I always think it's quite useful for exercise to see an exercise physiologist and get an exercise prescription that's actually right for you, someone who understands cancer and who can give you something that's tailored. Within, you know, you might have arthritis or other problems that limit your ability to exercise. If you go see an exercise physiologist, and there's lists of them you can get online of accredited exercise physiologists, they can really help. Because you do start to, if you're not moving around a lot and you're having treatment, you can lose muscle mass and lose condition really quickly. And exercise will help you get that condition back. And it's good for your mental well-being as well. You know, really, really excellent to do that. Needs to be a combination of aerobic and weight resistance work. But again, a good EP can help with that. Hobbies are really important. You can forget to do your hobbies because you're so busy either looking after someone or look after yourself. So reminding yourself about that sport when it's possible. And just pleasurable and restful distractions, you know, taking time to listen to music you like, watching a movie that you love, reading a good book. Again, things that we can forget how nice they are in the busyness of life and of treatment. And then my last point there is just mindfulness strategies. Mindfulness doesn't work for everyone. It works for some people. It's the idea of mindfulness. Again, it's from the Buddhist tradition. It's about trying to quieten your mind and be in the present. And so you can see how having a quiet mind can help with some of those negative thoughts that can drive distress. There are mindfulness resources that you can get online to teach you some simple mindfulness techniques. And if you want to get really stuck into it, you'd get an accredited teacher to train you. Have you had much experience with that?
I have personally. I've done mindfulness, but I was just going to take the opportunity to ask the difference between meditation and mindfulness, because mindfulness for me is something that I've learnt this year, and it helps actually give you clarity and helps you certainly be very present in the moment. But what is the difference between the meditation and mindfulness? Is there a significant difference there?
Not really. So there's lots of different ways to meditate, and if you read sort of Buddhist texts and things, you'll see all the different types, and you can buy tapes. You know, I've bought them with all the different ways to meditate. The mindfulness has meditation as part of it, but it's not just meditation. And there are different types of mindfulness programs that you can do. So the ones that I've been involved in have been mindfulness-based cognitive therapy, which has a focus on, it's got meditation in it, and it's also got a focus on what you're thinking is like, and all of them have present moment awareness. Does it make much difference between the two strategies? I don't know. Funnily enough, I've just been involved in a project in Hong Kong where I was helping some Hong Kong nurses actually do some research with people who are carers of people with dementia, comparing a couple of different mindfulness approaches, and there was no difference between the two of them. I'll share that with you. It's not been published yet, so it's all secret between us. You know, people, what you'll find is if you go to different practitioners who teach, they'll all have a different tradition that they work with. And I always think, be a little playful with it. And so if you try it with one practitioner and you don't like that, but you think there's aspects of it that might work for you, find someone else and ask around. I think some mindfulness programs have yoga in it too, you know. So, and I know in the mindfulness programs I've been working with, people weren't well enough to do yoga, so we had some being present in your movement activities that replaced yoga.
So does that bring in a bit like Tai Chi that you see, that mindfulness of each action?
I don't know. I'll be upsetting the Tai Chi people if I say what that is, because I don't actually know anything about Tai Chi.
But it's all those like yoga and Tai Chi are all very present.
Well, they're about awareness. I mean, the steps are, for all of these, generally, and then I'll stop because it's like you could go on forever about it. Yeah. It's about, first of all, but any psychological techniques are about awareness, first of all, trying to get aware of your own bodily reactions to the situation you're in, and then trying to get aware of what goes on in your head when you have those reactions, and then learning meditative techniques or yogic techniques to calm that down and to try and... They've got this thing they call cognitive fusion, which is the idea is that we have a negative thought and we act as if it's true and we grab onto it. Yeah. So a mindfulness approach differs from, say, a cognitive restructuring in that it's not trying to change that thought. It's just trying to say, be aware of that unhelpful thought and understand where it comes from and then detach from it. So kind of like an example would be, isn't that interesting? I've got that thought about X, Y, Z that always tends to upset me, but not being upset about it, kind of looking at the thought in a way. And the idea behind that is that we're always going to be in circumstances where unpleasant things happen in life and unpleasant thoughts drop into our heads. So the idea is to learn to see it, but not be it.
Be it, not act on it.
Not respond to it.
Not respond to it.
Yeah. Anyway. It's interesting stuff to read about, and if you're interested, if you don't like it, and that's okay, there's other things you can do. I was working with couples for a long time where the wife had cancer, and I would talk to the blokes sometimes about the idea that they could do some relaxation exercise, and they would go, love, I'd rather go water the garden, and I would say that's perfectly
that's
fine.
Okay.
Yeah. Because watering the garden is very relaxing and good for the garden too. Yeah. So now it's not moving again. There we go. Okay. So I've actually talked about all of that, so we can flick. Lots of different types of techniques for relaxation. Be a consumer. Try different relaxation techniques. See what you like. I do that. I've tried lots of different ones, and I get the ones that work for me. I'm a bit of an impatient person. I like a hard, short shot of stretch relaxation, and I have friends who like to do it for hours, so you just got to find your own thing. I've mentioned exercise and I've said all of these things, but really there's lots of, you know, even if it's just some light weight bearing that your exercise physiologist can show you how to do at home, these are really important things for keeping your condition and looking after yourself. I'm going to have to ask you to turn that because it's not working. Mm-hmm. There we go. No, no, sorry, back one. Okay, I think therefore I am. This is where I'm going to talk a little bit about thinking, and just, I've already said this, but I'll just briefly say it again. We do tend, how you think influences how you feel and respond, and we have automatic thinking patterns that can be unhelpful. Some of us jump to conclusions. The minute something happens, it's going to be bad now. That's what always happens. So jumping to the worst, seeing things through a negative lens as a tendency, all or nothing thinking. If I can't do this, then I can't do anything. Mm-hmm. And so it's kind of being rigid about your thinking that's unhelpful. This is just a quick slide to say it's really important in relationships to all of us to remember that what's going on affects each of us equally. So making time to communicate, trying not to mind read, not judge each other for our mm-hmm. responses, be kind, be fair, sometimes hard to do when you're under pressure, but it's important, mm-hmm. and reminding yourselves about what you share and what matters most between you when mm-hmm. perhaps some things aren't going so well.
Yeah.
Solving problems. We all think we just know how to solve problems, and when things are going well, we can normally do that pretty quickly, but when we're under stress, it can be, you can feel a bit lost. Be clear about what the problem is and what you actually want. We can be seeing a whole mess of things in front of us and not know where to start. So really getting clear about what is the main issue and how is it that you actually want it to change. Be informed. Generate all the possible actions you could take to address this and think about the pros and cons of different approaches. Be prepared to ask for help and support. And again, be flexible and change tack if needed. It might be that, for example, you think the problem is that your partner's being really irritating and they should just stop doing X, Y, Z, but when you really unpack it, it might actually be something else entirely, and understanding that and solving the real problem can be really useful. This is just a light-hearted quote. Do you all remember Stephen Bradbury, who was our one ice skater, right, that got a gold medal? And it's actually the 15-year anniversary of Steve Bradbury getting the gold. And he's now a motivational speaker. So if you could pay a lot of money, you could have him come talk to the Lung Foundation. But, you know, his story is, because remember, everybody fell over and then he sailed through and got the gold. And when he talks about it, I've read quite a bit on him. He says, you know, I knew I wasn't the fastest and I wasn't the toughest, but I knew what I could do. And my tactic was that I thought I will just hang in, run my own race, and if a couple of them fall over, I might get the bronze. And then, of course, they all fell over and he got the gold, which was an incredible moment. But what I like about Stephen Bradbury, other than his great optimism, is his acceptance of his limitations and running his own race and being okay with that. And so I find that quite inspiring, and I've had cancer patients tell me they like that story. Do you remember when he won the gold?
I do, which is amazing. I do remember. But I just love how you turn that around and you show him that he has actually, he had a plan.
He did.
And he stuck to that plan. And he openly admits that there are those weaknesses, and that if he just sticks to the plan, you'll get there.
Yeah.
I think that's really powerful. Yeah. Okay. And he's still in adverts. He's in a recent advert.
That is correct. And it is his 15-year anniversary.
There you go.
Okay. So I'm coming to the end of me talking at you. It's kind of hard not having you all in the room. But I think of all the years I've been working in the cancer area and listening to people's stories and learning from them, I think there are some important messages that I've picked up, and one of them is self-compassion, which we've been talking about, is just recognising a cancer experience is a bit of a marathon, and you've got to pace yourself and you've got to be kind to yourself. And really, you know, it sounds a bit simplistic saying be your own best friend, but you absolutely need to be your own best friend through this experience. And looking internally for your own strengths, whatever they are, is important, and you'll find that strength, it's in there. There's a rebuilding of your identity that happens after a cancer experience, because even though we know this is possible in life, we never really think it's going to happen to us or someone who's close to us. So working out who you are now, and anchoring back into what's important to you is really important, and then choosing your own path, which we've just been talking about in relation to Stephen, and knowing this is how you're going to run this marathon, this is how you're going to do it, and you get your supports around you and be kind to yourself, and you push ahead as you do that.
Absolutely.
And that is just a funny cartoon, because I like to put funny cartoons in talks, which I really like, because so I'm a psychologist, so I'm allowed to make psychologist jokes. I throw that in. And so we've got the gnome sitting, talking to the psychiatrist or the psychologist, and he's saying, no, I really am stuck in the weeds in the back of the garden. And I think that's kind of funny. But I guess I put that up there to just say, you know, take your own advice, listen to yourself, get help where you need it, run your own race.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Thank you so much, Suzanne. And I realise that we still have time if you want to ask Suzanne any particular questions. Please don't hesitate to reach out now. But I think while maybe possibly if you do want to ask some questions, I might just raise the importance of for patients to reach out to their clinicians, to their specialist team, because within that team, to access the likes of a social worker within a hospital as a point of contact to seek support if need be, a psycho-oncologist within the multidisciplinary team, palliative care. People are quite put off by the word palliative care because they feel that that's directly end-of-life care. In actual fact, yes, it is, but they can offer so much more in complementary therapies and the psychosocial aspects of supportive care for patients living with cancer. And also, moving away from the psychosocial aspect of things, the importance of your wellness of diet, and as you mentioned, exercise is so important in helping you look outwards, not as not looking always inwards, but keeping yourself looking out and keeping yourself active can have so many positive benefits for you. But I think also what you mentioned as well about mindfulness and meditation is so important to help keep balancing the clarity and perspective of the path that you're going down. It's so important. So I think what we've taken from today's talk is being flexible. I think that was one thing that really resonated with me in listening to you, is to go with the ups and downs of it, and there are going to be ups and there are going to be those down moments and there are going to be the plateau moments where you're sitting at that crossroad waiting for that next path to appear in front of you after you finish treatment and you're going, well, what now? So it is that flexibility just to keep moving with your journey with lung cancer. And the other one that I really liked hearing was clarity in your goals. What are your goals in this treatment? And again, just this morning in our face-to-face support group, asking a new patient to the group who, you know, what is your goal of treatment? It's really important to know, what is your goal going to be? But not just your goal in treatment, but your goal in personal goals as well.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, and goals can be really simple things. You know, I was mentioning earlier when we were chatting, my mother recently had a very bad experience with esophageal cancer, and our goals are very simple. Our goals is get strong enough so that I can take you to your favourite restaurant for lunch.
Beautiful.
It was really meaningful to her, it was meaningful to us, and that's what we work towards. Let's get you strong enough so that we can do this. And it means a lot to me that we did that. So just thinking about your own life, what brings pleasure to your life and meaning to your life, and making sure that we don't get so busy with everything that's going on around us that we forget to do those simple.
Yeah.
They're often really simple things. It doesn't have to be climbing a mountain.
It doesn't. No, it's the simplicity in it all that is so important. And along that path is also seeking the balance of it all. And, you know, even without cancer, we're all seeking, I think, balance in life. Adding that next layer of complexity, it makes it even harder. And the ability to remain honest in communication in family and with your clinician is so important. And there's so many different levels of communication, from family to friends to your treating team, and building up on the language as well. We didn't really touch on language today.
No, that's true. And again, letting people know what you want. I was talking just the other night to someone after I'd given a presentation, and we talked about, you know, your clinician can't mind read what's bothering you, and they're people like everyone else. So how about express to that person exactly how you want to cope with your cancer and how you want him to support you?
Yeah.
So he knows that. Yeah. And sometimes within relationships, the person with cancer and the partner may have different preferences, but you can negotiate that with your clinician too. You can say, this is the conversation you need to have with my partner, this is the conversation to have with me, and so they're very clear about what you need, and prevent something happening that becomes distressing. So it can seem like a lot of work to have to tell people things, but you know, they can't read your mind, and so you just you know, it's in your own interest to do that.
And it's hard when it's not a natural part of who you are, but it's something that you can learn along the way. So Suzanne, I don't think we have many questions coming through, which is absolutely fine. But I want to thank you so much for your time today and your generosity and your sharing your knowledge and your expertise. I think we're very fortunate as the Lung Foundation to have you on board, but also for the lung cancer community to be able to just fall back on to what you share today, which would be a fantastic resource for us to have in the future. So thank you
Claire.
so much.
I wish I got to meet you all in person, but I didn't. But, you know, I send my love and care out to all of you.
Thank you, Suzanne. Thank you. It means a lot to us, and to have people in your position to come in and to support lung cancer is just so, so important for us. So thank you. I think it's also just really important that you're aware of the supports that are there for you. Obviously, Lung Foundation, we do have the Australian Lung Trials Group that comes under the umbrella of the Foundation. We do have Shine a Light of Lung Cancer Awareness Month, which is in November, which you'll be able to access more information via our website. There's obviously myself, and information support that you can reach out for, educational resources, all evidence-based, that you can reach out through the 1800 654 301 free call number. And also, I think it's really important to link in and understand the benefits of Cancer Council within your state and territory. They're an amazing organisation, and I think it's really important that organisations like Lung Foundation are collaborating with cancer councils that are able to offer mindfulness courses. They also offer counselling, telephone support line as well. And they offer a diverse amount of supports, I'm basically saying. So please reach out to them on your 13 11 20 number. There is Lifeline as well, a 13 11 14 number. And there's a carer's couch that's run by an incredibly dynamic lady called Martine. And the reason I've left carer's couch and the number there for you to access is that also your carer, your loved one that is travelling this journey with you, I think is very important to recognise and to improve the supports for them as well. And it's an area that we'll continue to work towards to build to help the lung cancer community here as well. So later on today, there will be an email that will be sent to you with a survey for you to answer if you have the time and it's convenient, just to get feedback to ensure that we're meeting your needs, and that if you want to add further suggestions for the future webinars, we'd really welcome the feedback. So again, thank you so much for participating in our second Lung Cancer Connect webinar. We really value your involvement and wish you a fantastic rest of the day. And thank you again. Good night or good afternoon.